Hey, Nate, thank you very much. I really appreciate the introduction. I'm excited about this too. This is a topic that I'm passionate about, and how that we can incorporate the humanities into EMS education. EMS education was my first love. I've been a paramedic for almost 30 years. I've been in medical education, educating future physicians now for about 8 years. And I'm the director of students here at our medical school and university here at Lincoln Memorial University. We have about 450 students per class. I do a lot of the 12-lead EKG training and cardiology training in general. But one of the things that I do here is I run our certificate in medical humanities. Every student has the opportunity to participate in that certificate. It's an add-on to their diploma, and about half of the class chooses to do that. Practically every medical school, both allopathic and osteopathic medical school in our nation, has some form of medical humanities in the curriculum. And that's something that I feel as if could be a huge positive addition to the EMS curriculum in your program or other programs that you might be associated with, from the first responder, EMT, advanced EMT, even all the way to the paramedic and critical care paramedic level. I think incorporating the humanities into these discussions, let's face it, sometimes EMS education can be a little bit of a drag. It's lectures every day, skills labs every day, pressure every day. You've got a ton of information to deliver to students in a very short period of time. You know, our medical students get 4 hours of a didactic education. They have 2 hours in a class, two years in the classroom, 2 years in clinical rotations. And even after that, they have at least 3 years of residency. So they have 7 years to be prepared to face patients when they come out on the other end. With EMTs and paramedics, we may only have a few semesters. Paramedics may be a year to put those ladies and gentlemen into the field and have them in a position where they can thrive and excel in giving quality patient care. So the pressures associated with that can be very severe. And I think that's where the humanities can come into play in that regard, and many others too. As we go through here, we'll talk about those. I'm going to share my email address with you at the end, and I would be happy to correspond with you in any manner that you choose to talk about these things and how you could implement them in your program wherever you may be across the country. Okay, so some of you may recognize who this character is. This is Link out of The Legend of Zelda. Give yourself some extra credit if you got that one. I'm not a video game fan. My boys are. I have a son who lives in Seattle, another one who lives in Bristol, Tennessee, and they're both big video gamers. But this picture represents this quote, and this quote is from Neil Gaiman. If you don't know Neil is a prolific science fiction and fantasy writer. Love his books. They take you into worlds that you can't even imagine. But this quote really fits with what we're talking about today. And I don't like to read verbatim, but I'm going to here. Everybody has a secret world inside of them. All the people of the world, I mean everybody, no matter how dull and boring they are on the outside, inside of them, they've all got unimaginable, magnificent, wonderful, stupid, amazing worlds. Not just one world, but hundreds of them, thousands maybe. And how the reason that quote speaks to me is that as educators, and I'm sure most of you in this room today are educators, as educators, we have to remember that about our students, is that no matter how quiet the student is, no matter how shy or withdrawn the student is, I can promise you that that quote applies to them. No matter how much the student even gets, let's say it, the student gets on your nerves. He's a problem. She's a problem. But they also have these worlds. And what the humanities has an ability and a tendency to do is to pull those people into those worlds where they can be something that maybe they didn't even think they could be. And so it's a great way for this presentation to start, to keep that in mind, that every one of us have fantasies. Every one of us want to be more than what we are. All of us do. We all want to excel. We want to be somebody, okay? And having this platform to speak to you today is a thrill for me, because I want to share this kind of information with the EMS world and how we can use humanities to help our students to get to that point that they want to be and even reach even further than that. Hippocrates says, wherever the art of medicine is loved, there is also a love of humanity. So from the days of the earliest foundations of medicine, Hippocrates is the father of medicine, as we like to describe him. Even then, he knew, in his wisdom, he knew that the humanities had to be a part of medicine and caring for people with illness and morbidities, even then. So let's talk about the challenges that you have in EMS education. They're extreme, and I think in some ways they're getting tougher all the time. In my state, in the state of Tennessee, we have a huge EMS shortage. There are many factors and many reasons for that. One of the reasons for the EMS shortage in Tennessee, I really believe, is the fact that it takes you just as long now to become a paramedic as it does to become an associate's degree to RN. And as you know, the RN world pays more money. Let's just face it. That's just the truth. And so one of the things I think that drives the shortage of providers in the state of Tennessee is that very fact. So, but let's look at each of these, and you can talk in your own world if these apply to you or not. First is the decrease in student empathy. I've seen a huge decrease in the level of empathy in students. Remember, I've been in the EMS world for 30 years, still working on ambulance from time to time, getting a little too old for it now, but I still do it. And I've seen a change in the style of students that we get now. We used to get students who really wanted to be in the world. They love the idea of EMS and the challenges with EMS. And now I don't see that quite as much. And maybe you do in your location, but I don't see it as much here as we used to. There's a huge increase in burnout throughout training and practice. We also have burnout in the medical student education world too. The burnout factor here is really profound, and we're always trying to do things to help our students with burnout. And we continue to try to work on those initiatives to do that. The level of sophistication and expectation has grown higher. When I started as a paramedic, I could not have imagined being able to use rapid sequence induction procedures to intubate a patient, paralyze a patient, manage the airway. So what the expectations have become for paramedics and EMTs has exponentially increased from stakeholders, municipalities, county governments, state governments, whatever it happens to be. And so that makes our jobs as educators even harder. Shrinking numbers, as I said, there's just not nearly as many people going into a career in EMS now as there used to be. We could have a presentation, a two-hour presentation just on that alone, for sure. And then the hidden curriculum is also an issue. There's a hidden curriculum in medical education as well, not just in paramedic education or EMT education. The hidden curriculum being what those seasoned paramedics and EMTs tell your students is that, oh, that's not important, don't worry about that. You may even have preceptors that tell students that. That's an education thing. That'll never be important to you in the field. So the hidden curriculum becomes a problem. And again, I think that's where the humanities can help fight that. And finally, the algorithm approach in EMS education is something that I'm passionate also about us getting away from. We need to be training providers who are critical thinkers and know the pharmacology, know the treatment pathways, and not necessarily have to follow a cookie cutter algorithm pattern to get from point A to point B in patient care. And I also think the humanities may have a part to play in helping develop an approach to patient care that's outside of the algorithm approach. And we're focusing on critical thinking, critical decision making, so that we can get away from protocol manuals and get into the treatment modalities of medicine like other healthcare fields do. All right. So what are medical humanities? I've had people actually ask me that before. What are medical humanities? And simply, medical humanities are the human aspects of medicine, about touch and about compassion, about empathy, how that affects illness and how that affects health and how that affects well-being, social determinants of healthcare, all of those things. So the medical humanities are those things that make people what they are in their realm of their disability or their morbidity or health issue, okay? So basically what medical humanities does is it adds literature, philosophy, ethics. Ethics is a big one, guys. It's huge. Sociology, film, theater, psychology, religion, all of these precepts are incorporated into your curriculum that you're already teaching medical knowledge. You're teaching skill sets, those basic foundational skills that any person in EMS has to have. But what the medical humanities does is it adds those human elements to the training that you provide to your students. I have told people at the medical school that I work at now that it is much harder, and I want to tell you, I truly believe this, it is much harder to teach in a paramedic curriculum than it is in a medical school curriculum. And the reason I say that is some of you may be teaching a paramedic class all on your own, totally on your own. So that means you have to teach the cardiology and the pharmacology and the trauma and the endocrinology and the OBGYN problems. You have to teach all of that. At the medical school, we have specialists for each of those divisions. Each of those separations has a different faculty member. It's not all on one person. In your program, it may be all on you or someone else with you, but probably no more than two or three people. Oh, sure. Occasionally you bring in a special guest that talks about third trimester bleeding and those kind of things. But generally speaking, it is you. It is you. And so that's why that the humanities for EMS education is just as important, maybe even more so than in medical education, because of the sheer fact that you need the help to get the students from where you want them to be as people. So the medical humanities is about human beings. That's exactly what it's about. So what does that mean to EMTs and paramedics? It means what is our role in the preservation of humanity? One of the things that I abhor in EMS is when I see someone treat a patient poorly simply because they don't feel like that call or that request for care meets 911 standards. Without having any idea of why the person called, what the background is, what they face day to day, and plus it's not up to us to determine, it's up to us to treat and treat kindly. And that's what the medical humanities will help students to do. So let's go through these bullet points one at a time, and we'll talk about why humanities matter in medical education. First, they help us understand other people. They help us understand cultures. They help us understand languages. They help us understand histories of other cultures. I work in a medical school that looks like the United Nations every day that I'm here. And I still learn things every single day from students of other religions, other faiths, other cultures, other ethnicities. And so the medical humanities can also help your students in those same regards. And it's important in that factor. They foster social justice and equality. We have some video clips today that I think will help you underscore that. And I really think video clips and those type of things in the classroom can really help you boost the awareness of social justice and equality in your classrooms. They also reveal to us how people make decisions and how they make sense of the world, how they make moral decisions. You know, we're in the midst of a pandemic, and we're also in a political climate right now where the left can't believe anything the right says, or the right won't believe anything the left has said. And that has driven a lot of animosity in our country, and it doesn't matter to me if you're Republican or Democrat. That's not the point. The point being politics and the political inflammation, I guess you could say, of COVID has caused a lot of issues in our country. And the medical humanities can help your paramedic and EMT students kind of help fight through that or filter through that, if you will. The humanities teach empathy. Probably of all the things that we're talking about today, this is probably the most important. The humanities teach us to appreciate and understand and respect and care for other people, people that don't look like us, people that don't talk like us, people that don't have the same background that we do, people that aren't in the same social status as we are. It teaches us to have empathy for all of those people. And this certainly applies to EMS education. They teach us to deal critically and logically with subjective, complex, imperfect information. And subjective and complex is a definition of EMS. There are so many things that we have to encounter on a daily basis that we may have never encountered before. If a physician in the ER encounters something he's not ready for, he can consult that to someone else, and he can have the specialist come to the ER and help him with the care of that patient. A paramedic or an EMT in the back of an ambulance in the middle of a rural county has no one. So being able to process subjective, complex information is important, and the humanities can help with that. They teach us to weigh evidence skeptically, okay? There's a big push in EMS now to use best practices and to use research in formulating our protocols and our policies and our procedures. And the medical humanities helps us to be skeptical of things that we read. We as EMS educators have to be able to read research to see if that research is valid or not, to help to understand if the research methodology is appropriate and it actually proves what they say it proves, because sometimes research doesn't do that. And quite honestly, EMS has a long way to go in that regard compared to other disciplines in medical education. We've got a long way to go, but the humanities can help us with that too. Now, here we're going to start a little bit, show you some artwork and some literature and some poetry and some films and how you can use those in your classroom. Of course, the picture on the left, the print on the left, the portrait on the left is now. This is drawn in 2020 by an emergency room physician. And as you can see, that's a representation of what we are going through now with COVID. Okay. I still live in an area. I live in rural East Tennessee. We're about an hour north of Knoxville, Tennessee, about an hour, 2.5 hours south of Lexington, Kentucky. So I live in a very conservative area where a lot of people still think COVID is a political ploy. And there's still plenty of people around here that don't wear masks in anything, in any store, any restaurant, anywhere for that matter. And we haven't, Tennessee is one of those states that hasn't really shut much of anything down. And so this representation of COVID is, it really is impactful for me because I understand what it means for my home base, my county, my city. The one on the right is actually from a lithograph from a textbook that was written in 1567. This was the first anatomy textbook that was published and distributed widely. And as you can see, the cover depicts a dissection of, it looks like a child. And you can see all the people gathered around to view the dissection. No one has any PPE on. No one has gowns or masks or anything of any kind. Okay. So you can see the dichotomy that you have with these two different pieces of artwork. This, the one on the right from 1567, the one on the left from 2020. But really, in many ways, nothing really has changed. It's still the same kind of thing. And then this last one I'm going to put in here, this is artwork from 2019. And this artwork represents the disease processes that can plague us to this day: tuberculosis, plague, smallpox, Ebola, West Nile virus, anthrax, drug-resistant bacteria, on and on and on. And why these things are so beautiful to share with your classes, your students, is it generates discussion. It allows you to find out what the students' opinions are and if they're worried about infectious diseases in their own practice. And if you're a paramedic or an EMT practicing on an ambulance and you're not worried about infectious disease, you're very naive. You're very naive. Okay. And so this helps to generate those discussions. It helps you to frame those discussions in a way that you want it to go, to impress upon students that, yes, this is impactful to us. It's very hard in EMS, as you well know, to wear the proper PPE in every circumstance. Sometimes it's almost nearly impossible, but there we are. And we're facing COVID in a situation where we may not be able to don the proper PPE because of that. Somebody walks into your station, rings the doorbell, you knock on the door, they knock on the door, you let them in. They've got a low-grade fever, a cough, the whole thing, and now you're not prepared. And it happens routinely day to day. And this is why art and literature helps you drive those conversations. Here's a research study that says that new research finds medical students who enjoy music and art have qualities that make them better and less stressed doctors. So I can share this with you. If that works for physicians and medical students, it's going to work for paramedics and EMTs and paramedic and EMT students. So if we can use music and the art, many of you may use music to relax. I'm a huge smooth jazz lover. And I, every night when I get home, I'll chill, I'll turn on my Alexa, and I'll listen to some smooth jazz, maybe have a glass of wine, and it just helps me decompress. And that's why the medical humanities would also help your students decompress, even in the classroom. Maybe you're coming back from lunch and you play a little ambient music for them to relax into before they get into the labs in the afternoon. whatever it happens to be. But this was a large multi-cohort study that proved that the humanities helped doctors become less burned out and less stressed because of it. The humanities also help us with inclusivity and diversity. Our country has a lot of racial issues right now because of many different reasons, many different factors. The humanities will help us fight through that. The humanities helps us see through that. The humanities helps us frame that. It also helps with ethical decision making, religion and culture. And then I want to talk about narrative medicine in just a minute, but it helps with all of these fields of humanity. And in EMS, certainly, we have plenty of ways to improve the delivery of care by understanding those fields of humanity. Now, narrative medicine is exactly what it says. It's letting someone narrate their circumstances. And if you don't do this in your classroom, I would absolutely recommend that you start doing this as soon as possible. Invite someone to your classroom who had cancer and fought it, who has cancer still fighting it, okay? Invite someone into your classroom who had COVID and recovered. Invite someone into your classroom who lost a loved one because of COVID. Invite someone into your classroom who's disfigured from trauma. Invite someone from your classroom who has HIV or AIDS. When students can hear this narrative story from these patients and to understand what they went through, there's a book out there from a neurologist who she had an ischemic stroke, and it's an amazing story of resilience. Invite someone into your classroom who has had a stroke and has problems associated with a stroke. Maybe they can't use their left side. Maybe their speech is impaired. But it helps those students to connect to those stories of morbidity and to help them understand that every single patient that they encounter is loved by someone. They have a father and a mother, a brother and a sister, a wife and a daughter, kids, and it impacts those students to understand that this is just not my 13th call of the day. This is a human being that has issues and has a story, and narrative medicine will allow you to share that with your students in a safe space where they can ask questions, and it's a valuable tool. We use it here at the medical school all the time, continuously. Here's another study that was medical students' exposure to the humanity correlates with positive personal qualities and reduced burnout. Notice the second highlighted quote, as humanity's exposure increased, physical fatigue, emotional exhaustion, and cognitive weariness all decreased. And exposure to the arts more strongly predicted wisdom. More strongly predicted wisdom. Empathy and openness to possibilities raises questions and sheds light to the mutual benefit of both. So we have research study after research study after research study in the medical education field that says that the humanities help. Now, there's not a lot of study in the EMS education field about what role the humanities can play. However, you can understand that medical students and EMS students are the same. The correlations are the same. So if it works for medical students, it's going to work for EMS students, and it's going to work in your classroom. We talk a lot right now about social determinants of health and the access to healthcare and the quality healthcare and the access to prenatal care and all of those things. And what the medical humanities can also do is make students very aware of social determinants of health and why some people don't have prenatal care and why some people don't take their kids to the doctor to get vaccinations because they can't. And the medical humanities can help frame all of that. And it's your creativity is what it depends on. And we'll talk about that toward the end of this. Now, there are artifacts to deliver humanities content, and I've listed some here, and some of these are fantastic. I will say this, assigning books in an EMS classroom is folly. You're wasting your time. I'm going to chuckle when I say that, but if you tell your classes to read a book, it's not going to happen. If you tell them to read a quote from a book and come back and talk about what they think that means, then they'll probably do that. But this day and time, the students that we get most likely are not going to read a book that you assign to them. Okay, but we have a molecular fundamentals of medicine professor here that starts every class out with poetry. He reads the students a poem at the beginning of every 1 hour lecture that he delivers. And let me just tell you, they love it. They absolutely love it. They talk about it. They frame it with regard to medical education. And he is well known for it and well respected because of it. Movies. I've got several movies clips that we're going to look at today. And movies help with the humanities so much. They can help you students understand their patients. Podcasts are great. Podcasts can be a little problematic because sometimes they're hard to find what you really want to look at. And some of the podcasts can be as long as 2 hours. TED Talks are fantastic. And you probably already use TED Talks in your curriculum. I always did when I taught paramedics. Art is fantastic. We're going to look at some art samples today that will help you in the classroom and help frame some great discussions. Even comic books can help with that regard and framing discussions. And just stimulating conversation is what we're trying to do. And to make students maybe open their eyes to a different world than what they believed in. Remember, all of us, myself included, are products of our environment. We're products of how we were raised. We're products of what types of people we were raised around. And we are all products of our environment. And what we're trying to do was trying to bring that student out of that environment to expand that environment to make him consider other possibilities. And then finally, music. And we all love music. Everybody's music listeners. As I mentioned, I'm a jazz guy. Love to listen to jazz. It just relaxes me. And using music in the classroom, especially like segueing, I get excited about this, segueing between labs, okay? Having music playing in the hallway to help students relax and to chill out before they have to do something and they have to have performance anxiety. You know how much nervous that makes the students when they have to do that. So we want to use prompts with any type of artifact that we want to use. And simply a prompt is, if you're using a movie clip, you want to know what you want to know. You want to know going into that, before you play that movie clip, you want to know what you're going to ask of the students at the end of that movie. And you want it to be open-ended. Don't just ask a yes or no question. Give them a broad statement that they have to think about it and they have to process it and they have to give you a response based on what they just saw in the clip that you decided to show for that day. And again, this could be the first 10 minutes of the day. If you're like we are in the state of Tennessee, most education days are 8 hours for paramedics. They have lecture in the morning and lab in the afternoon, and that's usually 2 days a week. Take your first 10 to 15 minutes of every morning and talk about something in the medical humanities realm and make those students discuss current events. COVID, for God's sake, we could certainly talk about COVID for every day, but we don't want to beat that to death either. Here's an example of a great program that I think is that would be well received in your programs. This is from the University of Arizona College of Medicine. They call it the Healer's Heart. They get together and they talk about the meaning of service and the awe of medicine. They talk about mindfulness and they talk about grief and what it means to be a physician and what it means to be a paramedic. And I want to share with you, and this is not a mindfulness lecture that we're having here today, but mindfulness, being mindful of yourself and others and your circumstances, is a fabulous tool to put in your toolbox. We do mindfulness and meditation sessions here at the medical school all the time. Faculty and staff and students get together. And then we talk about things and we talk about service to humanity. We do meditation and we talk about things that bother us to our core. But remember, we are in a service industry, in a service field. And having that awe for that level of service is something that we should impress upon our students. Here's Rachel giving birth to Joseph from 1642. When you're starting an OBGYN lecture, use this art. Put it up there the first day when we started to talk about OBGYN. And we're talking about what has happened in medicine from 1642 until now. What would have happened to Joseph in 1642 that's different from 2020? And this artwork helps to frame that so well. You can see she's going to deliver this baby at home. They don't have her. She's just got people taking care of her. None of these people are trained, and they're just as nervous about the circumstance as she is. And it helps us to frame a discussion about how far medication has come and the practice of medicine has come. Now, here's a clip that will help you understand human grief and human emotion. I will frame it by saying there's some off-color language in here, but it's part of it and needs to be there. So here we go.
I never saw anything like that before.
What do we got? Have the father do a positive ID at the morgue.
Blood's from a split in the crown of her head. She was beaten with some kind of stick, but that didn't kill her. She was shot a second time. Looks like a 38.
What the fuck am I gonna tell him? Hey, Jimmy. God said you owed another marker. You came to collect.
I would recommend that you play that video or something similar to that the first day of class when you're talking about roles and responsibilities, to see the human emotion in that clip and to make EMS students understand that they're going to face that type of emotion routinely in their career can really, really implant a seed in their brain to understand the seriousness of what they're about to undertake. And those type of clips are very important in setting that tone or setting that standard. Here's another piece of artwork that you can use in your class. I have set this one in the form of a poem too, and you can see the grief in this old man, and his life is not what he wanted it to be or hasn't been what he thought it would be. And the poem simply says, "It feels like the skies have given up on hope, and I'm forced to live on the fleeting moments of the happy past." And again, this is a conversation you can have with students about when someone loses a loved one, a husband loses a wife, a father loses a son, a mother loses a daughter, and you are now there in that world. We are not supposed to be in that world. We are transplanted into that world because of the career that we chose. EMS deals with things that human beings should not have to deal with. And the reason Humanities helps with that is that it helps your students to frame this early in their career so they can be a little better prepared for it as they move forward. I love talking about the biles. Hippocrates thought that the human body had four biles: blood, phlegm, yellow bile, and black bile. And that in the day was considered medical knowledge, okay? And you can use this or something similar to this to again frame how far medicine has came in our world from the time of Hippocrates, where they thought that all those biles changed you into what you are. We now have CT scans, we have x-ray, we have all of these tools that we have that came from this, the father of medicine, who believes something that we now know to be completely false. It's wrong. It's just wrong. But at that time, that's what they believed. Here's another clip. This is a little more joyful, I believe, and I think you'll enjoy it too.
Who is it that I aspire to be? That is the question that we should be asking ourselves all the time. What kind of person am I? So this is what we're gonna do. Everyone's gonna come up with two things that they think everybody else should know about them. All right, I'll go first. Number one, I used to work on Wall Street for a long time. And two, I left Wall Street to pursue my dream and teach. Boom, who's next? Yes.
Julian Albans, and I think it's cool how you're pursuing your dream.
Thank you very much, Julian. Let's hear your two things.
Okay. One, I just got Battleground Mystic on my Wii, and it's totally awesome. And number two, we got a ping pong table this summer.
Amazing. Any questions for Julian? Yes.
Is Battleground Mystic multiplayer or single player?
That's not those kind of questions. Okay.
Hi, my name's August Pullman Augie, and I have a sister named Bia and a dog named Daisy. I love Star Wars, and I just said three things. Yeah, sorry.
That sounds like a bonus to me, three things. Thank you very much, Augie. That was perfect. Who's next?
Oh, I actually have a question for Augie. What's to do with the braid in the back of your hair? Is it like a Padawan thing?
What's a Padawan thing?
Oh, it's from Star Wars. Padawan is a Jedi apprentice. Who's your favorite character, Augie?
Boba Fett.
What about Darth Sidious? Do you like him?
Ouch.
Okay, can we talk about Star Wars at recess? Yes? All right. Who wants to read this month's precept? What about you? What's your name?
Summer.
Summer. Want to give it a shot?
When given the choice between being right or being kind, choose kind.
So when given the choice between being right and being kind, be kind. You saw the kid, the male kid, was being a little bit of a jerk and trying to make fun of the kid because he had some facial deformities. And again, that's just another clip that helps us to frame what it means to be a provider of emergency care and how we treat people. Just like this homeless gentleman right here. I want my students and I want your students to treat this gentleman exactly the same as they would treat someone who lives in a mansion. And the reason that the humanities are important is it will help you develop that in those students so that they can treat this gentleman the same as they treat the mayor of your community. No different. Because if we all treat everyone the same, we never have to make any apologies. And humanities will help us do that. Here's a fresco from 1445, and this depicts the Black Plague. And you all know of the Black Plague when it disseminated most of the world's population. A third of Europe's population was killed by the Black Plague. And this fresco was done about a century later to depict the Black Plague. I'm sorry. But you can see the amount of discussion that this could have, especially in the pandemic that we have with COVID. Obviously, COVID has not yet been proven to be as deadly as the plague, obviously. And they didn't have you can talk about hygiene. You can talk about PPE. You can talk about barriers to protection. You can talk about ignorance and lack of understanding of medicine. There are so many things that this type of artwork can help you to help your students to understand. Here's a few quotes from literature that I enjoy and I think you could share with your class. But again, it's just whatever you want to do. It's your world. You create it the way you want it, okay? A couple of these I think are really good. The one at the bottom, she had waited. This is from Their Eyes Were Watching God. She had waited all her life for something, and it had killed her when it found her. From A Tree Grows in Brooklyn, dear God, she prayed, let me be something every minute of every hour of my life. And from The Invisible Man, life is to be lived, not controlled. And humanity is won by continuing to play in face of certain defeat. I could have an hour-long conversation with a class about that quote alone. Life is to be lived, not controlled, and humanity is won by continuing to play in face of certain defeat. I know so many correlations that there are with that quote with medical education. When a student fails an exam, when a student has to redo a practical exam, a student gets dismissed from your program. There are so many ways to frame these type of quotes. And this is just five. There are billions out there that would work for you in a certain circumstance. I could see where you could put a PowerPoint slide up and it had nothing but that Ralph Ellison quote. And you turn to the class and you say, tell me what that means to you. Tell me what that means to you. And have a great discussion about the different viewpoints that that one sentence can cause. Here's the death of Superman. Golly, you could have a whole lot of discussion about what happens when the world's hero dies. What happens when your protector dies? What happens when your wife dies? What happens when your husband dies? What happens to that person who is your world dies? And just that picture alone of the death of Superman lying on the concrete at the foot of this monster that killed him could drive every bit of that discussion on how you frame that. Here's a fabulous video that talks about social justice. It's a short one.
Now, one day y'all gonna be with me and you best bet we gonna get pulled over. Now, I don't mean I did something wrong. Maybe I made a mistake driving, or maybe I ain't do nothing at all. You gonna see me with my hands like this on the dashboard. Come on. Now you keep your hands posted, cause moving makes the police get all nervous. If I ain't with you, you ask for me. It can get real dangerous, so don't argue with them. But keep your hands where they can see them.
So that video is really impactful to me, and I like to use it in lectures because I'm not a black man. I don't understand how that is. I can't picture that, but the humanities make me understand it and make me be empathetic to it. It helps your students to become more empathetic to the plight of different races, different cultures, different ethnicities, and what they have to face as a Caucasian man. I've never faced, never had to, never worried about it. I've been pulled over by the police several times from speeding. Ask my wife, she'll tell you. But I've never had to worry about any of that. They treat me politely, nicely, and this is not a bashing the police lecture. That's not what I'm even trying to, the point I'm making here, and I hope you understand my point. It helps our students to understand different perspectives, okay? These two pictures that I've got here, the one on the left is called Anguish, and as you can see, that certainly depicts anguish. The one on the right, I don't have the title, but what the artist is trying to represent is how this young man, this young black man, feels invisible, that people see right through him in his world, in his culture, in his social setting. And so both of those help to describe and to understand pain. One more clip, and this is talking about human suffering and human pain and what it means to be human.
Ms. G, can I read something from my diary?
That'd be great.
Who's he?
Man, he's been with us since freshman year, fool.
What's his name?
The summer was the worst summer in my short 14 years of life. It all started with a phone call. My mother was crying and begging, asking for more time, as if she were gasping for her last breath of air. She held me as tight as she could and cried. Her tears hit my shirt like bullets and told me we were being evicted. She kept apologizing to me. I thought I have no home. I should have asked for something less expensive at Christmas. On the morning of the eviction, a hard knock on the door woke me up. The sheriff was there to do his job. I looked up at the sky, waiting for something to happen. My mother has no family to lean on, no money coming in. Why bother coming to school or getting good grades if I'm homeless? The bus stops in front of the school. I feel like throwing up. I'm wearing clothes from last year, some old shoes and no new haircut. I kept thinking I'd get laughed at. Instead, I'm greeted by a couple of friends who were in my English class last year. And it hits me, Mrs. Gerwell, My crazy English teacher from last year is the only person that made me think of hope. Talking with friends about last year's English and our trips, I began to feel better. I received my schedule, and the first teacher is Mrs. Gerwan, room 203. I walk into the room and feel as though all the problems in life are not so important anymore. I am home.
That's from a movie called Freedom Riders. And if you've never watched that, as an educator, I would recommend that you do. It's a fantastic movie. It talks about, you know, perceptions, preconceived notions about students and their attitudes and their beliefs and what it should do for you, and what that clip should do for you and for your students is to understand that we don't know someone's circumstances. We don't know what they deal with every day. You notice his classmates didn't even know who he was because his life was so chaotic that he just didn't talk to anyone. He was very quiet, very reserved. And you may have students in your classroom that are facing those same type of obstacles, those roadblocks, and helping them through the humanities will help them to get through that. And that's what she did. They read a lot of literature. It's a fabulous movie if you get a chance to watch that. So teaching and learning through the humanities, you want to try to incorporate empathy in your classroom, nurture dignity, respect, and confidentiality. Foster role modeling. Make your paramedic students be role models for your EMT students. Have your EMT students be role models for your EMR students. Okay. Train students to be humanistic and address that hidden curriculum. Do that in your classroom. You'll be well served for it. And I love this. It's your world. Be creative. You can do whatever you want to do. You can do it however you want to do it. I would say this, though. Don't do anything on the fly. Plan it. Process it. Make sure the clip works for what you want it to work for. Make sure the poetry works for what you want to work for. And give them the correct prompt to dig that out of them when you play the video. Then ask a question that requires more than a yes or no answer. Ask a question that they have to ponder and they have to reflect upon. Here's a quote that I love from Winston Churchill, and I think this is exactly where we are in EMS education right now, is that we are shaping the world faster than we can change ourselves, and we are applying to the present the habits of the past. And what that means to me is that we can't continue to do the same old things and expect different results. We are going to have to change the dynamic of our classroom to foster more humanism, or more humanistic and empathetic students that we place out into the field. And as you know, all of you have been in the field and may still be in the field. The field starts to sour us. It does. We all know that it does. EMS is a tough profession, and the field starts to sour us from the job itself almost. And we need to do something to ramp that up and to make people be passionate and love the career that they have chosen. And I think we do that in initial education through the use of humanities. One more for you, and this is for you and you alone.
Hey, Mr. Grumpy Gills. When life gets you down, you know what you gotta do?
I don't wanna know what you gotta do.
Just keep swimming, just keep swimming, just keep swimming, swimming, swimming. What do? We swim, swim.
Dory, no singing.
Dory. I love to swim in.
Dory.
When you want to swim, you want
See,
to
See, I'm gonna get stuck now with that song. Now it's in my head.
Sorry.
Now you guys are gonna say just keep swimming all day long. The last slide here says questions, but the artwork is generated from a paramedic. I think he's out of Canada. I came across his website a few months ago, and his artwork is fantastic. And this one I thought was a perfect one to end this presentation. That's us in the foreground, and that's what we deal with in the background. And using the humanities to help fight that monster is going to help you and your classmates and your classrooms tremendously. Okay, so I'm going to kick out of this, and I'm going to open it up for questions. If anybody has any questions, we'll be happy to answer those.
Awesome. Thank you so much for that presentation. It was very powerful. We do have a couple of questions, but first I want to start with a few comments that were sent in through the chat.
Sure.
We had one person send in their primary mantra in all settings. I think this is a really wonderful way to kind of boil all this down in a way that's digestible and help reinforce that these things are important when you're busy, preoccupied, maybe out on a call. Just the saying that our humanity is the most important tool in our toolbox. I think that's it's a wonderful way, just a line to keep in your mind as you're carrying out many things that it's in many situations, the most important thing to keep in the back of your head is to maintain the perspective of humanity.
And I love that mantra, and I'm going to steal that if you don't mind. That is fabulous, and I've never heard it really framed that way. But yeah, that's fabulous, and I think hopefully this will open up some eyes for some people today. Thanks, Nate.
Yeah, absolutely. And so the next one is, it's often difficult, especially in high call volume areas, for paramedics to balance the humanity inside with the inhumanity that they're witnessing outside, and to deal with the outside themselves. I don't know if you have any comments with that, or how you can maybe look past what you're being forced to experience.
I've faced that myself when I was a practicing critical care paramedic. The one thing that I could not tolerate, and I had to figure it out for myself, is not overt child abuse, but child neglect. I had a hard time with child neglect, and so if I was called to a home to treat the father who had chest pain, it affected my care because I was often worried about those children who I knew were being neglected. And I just had, from a humanistic standpoint, had to put that behind me and say that there are bigger issues here than I can deal with. But here's what I always told my children, and they're all adults now, all in medicine. My son's a pediatric dentist. I have a daughter who's a psychiatric nurse practitioner. I have another son who's a PA. And I always told them, the only thing that I can control is my attitude. I can't really control anything outside of my world, but I control my attitude. And I think that's what we have to do. That's what we have to do. Hillary, I saw your comment about speaking and presenting this at EMS World Expo. I would be honored to do that if you're still here.
Wonderful. And like I said, I'll make sure to include your email in the follow-up email that goes out to everybody that's in attendance. So if you have any questions or anything that you'd like to follow up with, you will have that sent directly to your email. We do just have a quick question while we have a few minutes left. If anyone else has any more questions or comments, we do still have a few minutes left in the hour that we can go ahead and address those. But have you faced resistance with any of this stuff, with trying to implement it in your own practice? Are there people that you have found or experiences where people either disagree or push back on any of these concepts?
I'll be honest with you, even at the medical school level, and I'll just share this with you. We have faculty that think that it's kind of, and they're great people. This is not a criticism of the faculty, but we have faculty that think sometimes they think the certificate of medical humanities that we have is a little silly. They think it's a little high schoolish, a little amateurish, because we do a lot of things like this. We'll play a movie. We'll have poetry readings. We'll do meditation. Anything to try to center you as a human being. And sometimes I think they think that's a little, not worthy of medical school education, I guess is the best way to put it. Again, not a criticism of the person. They're fabulous people. It's just their viewpoint is different than mine, and maybe different than some of the people that are on the panel here today. I've always been a person that believes that we can always learn and be better people. And that's a daily ritual for me and a daily chore for me that I have to do that. So as far as adversity or facing obstacles, yes, we have, but I think you try to fight through those. You're going to have students that think this is stupid. You're going to have students that don't want to participate. They're going to be offended by it, almost not happy about it, a waste of their time. Why are we not in the lab? But if you, again, take the time and watch Freedom Writers. It's an hour and a half of your afternoon. You can get it on Netflix probably. And it will help you understand how to start this and help you understand how you can take a student from here to here in one semester just with using the humanity. So, and I'd be happy to help any of you with any of this that I can. And he will give you my email address and you can give me a shout.
Absolutely, absolutely. So our last question so far, it's kind of, we had two come in that sort of, I think, are touching on the same topic, but do you have any programming protocols for training or official curriculum, recommended curriculum that you would follow while as far as implementing medical humanities?
Not specifically, but I will tell you a place I would go to start and to plagiarize some of their work. Go to Stanford University's medical school and just Google Stanford MUSE, M-U-S-E. Stanford has a humanities program that is absolutely fabulous. And that's where I would start. They have all kinds of resources, all kinds of tools for your disposal. And it's, from what I understand, most of it's free. And they'll at least even give you a link of almost every medical school in the country that has a humanities program and how that program works. So you can steal, there's no reason to reinvent the wheel here. You can steal a lot of great ideas from these other institutions. And I would start at Stanford. That's where I would go first.
Wonderful. Thank you, sir. And we did get a comment sent in just to the panelists. Thanks, Bill, for sending this in. Freedom Writers is free on Amazon Prime until the end of this year. So,
oh, thanks, Bill. You got just a few days, guys. Get in there and watch that because you'll love it. I promise you, you will.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, I thank you so much for this presentation. This has been full of incredibly applicable information that I know people can take and immediately implement in their own lives and their own practices. So this has been super helpful and really valuable. I really appreciate you taking the time to give this presentation. Did you have anything you wanted to address before we go and sign off?
No, it's been my pleasure to be here. It's always an honor to do anything for NMC and the organization. I'm passionate about EMS education, even though I'm really not in that world anymore. But if there's anything I can do to help any of the attendees, Nate's going to give you my email address. Please shoot me an email and I will be happy to correspond with you. Okay. And Merry Christmas and happy holidays to all of you.